Radio.
I see my name in shiny lights. Yeah, a different city every night. Oh, I swear the world better prepare for when I'm a billionaire.
It's time to get down to business on the weekend's number one business program. Known as the King of Networking, your host, Shalom Klein, has worked with thousands of entrepreneurs and created countless jobs. So, to success, let's get down to business.
We are all about small business, jobs, and entrepreneurship. And business, we talk a lot about business here. You are on with Get Down to Business, and I'm your host, Shalom Klein. Remember, you can always download podcasts from Get Down to Business on my website at shalomklein.com. Brand new website, by the way. And while you are there, don't forget to follow me on Twitter, at Shalom Klein. It's going to be a jam-packed week of content and information you won't want to miss. It's a live show. You can call in at 312-642-5600. And, of course, encourage you to contact our wonderful sponsors at Tandem HR. Visit their website, tandemhr.com, or give them a call, 630-928-0510. So my first guest here in studio has had a illustrious 36-year career at the Jewish Federation of Metropolitan Chicago. Mike Tarnoff has turned his attention to what he believes is the crisis in electoral politics in the United States, and now is the founder and chairman of Make Every Vote Matter. He's intent on reforming the national election process by increasing people's awareness of the importance of the right to vote and making every vote important. Mike Tarnoff, thank you so much for joining us here in studio. It's great to have you.
It's great to be here. Thank you.
Absolutely. So tell me a little bit about Make Every Vote Matter and how you got interested in the topic in general.
Well, going back 50 years to when I first became eligible to vote, which was in the 1960s, I realized that here in Illinois, no matter which party or presidential candidate I preferred, my vote didn't really matter because the electoral votes in the state of Illinois are basically predetermined. As a result, for many years, I personally did not vote in presidential elections. Then, in 2010, after my career, and thank you for mentioning that, I turned 65 and I began to focus on my retirement, which led me to think back to my frustration and anger about the Electoral College, how it distorts presidential campaigns, disenfranchises voters, and drives partisanship. In talking to others across the political spectrum, it soon became clear to me that I was not the only one who feels this way. It was then that I decided I would use my retirement years to make a difference by establishing an organization that would work to make every vote matter by electing the president under a one-person, one-vote electoral process.
So, Michael, you just mentioned talking to some of your colleagues and friends across the political spectrum and across the political aisle. You're indicating that Make Every Vote Matter is apolitical and nonpartisan. Is there really support for this on both sides of the aisle?
There sure is. Eliminating the Electoral College has been an apolitical, nonpartisan movement for at least 50 years. Back in 1969, the U.S. House of Representatives voted for a national popular vote by 338-70 margin, which included over 90% of the Republican representatives in the House at that time. Recent and past Republican presidents and presidential candidates who supported direct election to the president include George H.W. Bush, Bob Dole, Gerald Ford, and even Richard Nixon. A book titled Every Vote Equal by John Koza has forewords written by members of both parties, including 12 Republicans who have served either in the House or the Senate of the United States Congress. On the Democratic side of the aisle, Senator Barbara Boxer, Senator Dick Durbin, and, of course, Al Gore have all indicated they think it's time to eliminate the Electoral College.
Fascinating to hear those names and those examples. Are there other nationally known independent groups that support this effort?
Sure there are. To name a few, the American Bar Association supports elimination of the Electoral College. Their website has an article titled, "The Electoral College Flunks the Test in an Age of Democracy," written by John B. Anderson. The League of Women Voters also believes that the Electoral College should be abolished. Their position can also be viewed on their website. And the New York Times editorial board published an editorial opinion titled "Let the People Pick the President" on November 7th. Now, I know we all know that not everyone agrees with the editorial page of the New York Times. However, it's worth noting that once an issue reaches their editorial page, it means that it's an issue that's become part of our national conversation.
So you have a very interesting proposal, clearly supported by both those independent groups, as well as seemingly folks on both sides of the aisle. But would eliminating the Electoral College benefit any one party or any other specific group?
No one really knows for sure. Right now, the voter turnout in this country is consistently 10 to 15% larger in the 10 or 11 swing states than it is in the other 39 or 40 flyover states. There's reason to estimate that in a popular vote, there might be perhaps 20 or 25 million more voters, and the winners on a state-by-state basis would cease to matter at all. If you add 20 to 25 million new voters into the mix, no one can say that would benefit Democrats or Republicans or some sort of yet-to-emerge independent third party. All candidates would have an equal opportunity to convince these millions of new voters that their platform is better. The bottom line is, even though we can't predict the outcome, more voters would be motivated to exercise their right to vote.
The Electoral College has been around for quite a while. Our founding fathers, I think it's fair to say, were pretty wise and pretty smart. Is it wise to tinker with the system that they established for electing our president?
Well, we certainly agree that the founding fathers were indeed really smart. That's exactly why they had the foresight and the wisdom to provide for a process to amend the Constitution. That process has actually been used 27 times in our 241-year history. One might ask, how do you feel about the First Amendment? That's the one that gives us both freedom of religion and speech. Most people are pretty happy with that one. How do you feel about the Fifth Amendment, the right to refuse to testify against yourself? The point that I'm trying to make here is that the Founding Fathers clearly knew that things could and would change over time, and that changes to their document over time would be both necessary and wise. Debating and ultimately enacting amendments when deemed necessary is in fact exactly what the Founding Fathers wanted us to do.
Would we need a constitutional amendment in order to elect the president by popular vote?
No, not necessarily. There's a movement called the National Popular Vote Interstate Compact, which was founded in 2006. This compact provides that if a combination of states totaling 270 electoral votes joins the compact, then they all will agree to instruct their electors to vote for the winner of the national popular vote. In that way, the winner of the national popular vote will become the president. This process means that the Electoral College would be preserved, but the winner of the popular vote and the winner of the Electoral College vote would always be the same person. The really interesting thing is that this compact has already made significant inroads on a state-by-state basis. 11 states with 165 electoral votes have already adopted this compact. It's also been passed by at least one house in 12 additional states with 96 electoral votes and has been approved unanimously by committee votes in two additional states with 27 electoral votes. It's worth noting that a number of the legislatures where this has already been approved are in Republican-controlled states.
Very, very interesting. We're chatting with Michael Tarnoff, the founder and chairman of Make Every Vote Matter, and really fascinating subject, clearly something that impacts our community, and it's certainly it's in the news quite a bit right now. It's been in the news for the past year, and Mike is proposing, I think, a fascinating approach with a lot of backup and a lot of research and a lot of history over here, so appreciate it. Mike, we are quickly running out of time, but I want to try to learn just a little bit more. Under a popular vote system, wouldn't the four or five biggest cities in America control the outcome?
That's a popular myth, Shalom, but it's simply not supported by the factual data. There are three simple facts about the biggest cities in the U.S. The first one is that the five biggest cities represent about 5% of the total population. And even if you go to the 50 biggest cities, that constitutes about 15% of the population. The second fact is that the voters in these big cities are not and have never been unanimously in favor of one party or the other. The votes in many of these cities are often more like 60-40 or even closer margins. And the third important fact is that some of the biggest cities are located in primarily blue states, while others are located in primarily red states. When you consider these three facts together, the bottom line is that it becomes mathematically impossible for anyone to win a national popular vote by concentrating only on the big cities in America.
So make every vote matter. You've been involved in this effort sort of in your retirement. So it sounds like that whole retirement thing is not working out exactly as planned. You need more people to get involved. What can people do to support Make Every Vote Matter?
Well, thank you for asking that question. There are three things everyone can do. First, please go to www.makeeveryvotematter.org and donate whatever you can. The amount doesn't matter. Every single contribution, just like every single vote, makes a difference. Second, follow us on Facebook and share this information with your friends. Third, call and write letters to your elected representatives and to your local newspaper editors and let them know that you support one person, one vote.
Thank you, Mike Tarnoff. We'll be right back.